In this video, we quickly summarize the SI prefixes that we commonly use in physics. Then we work a couple examples of how to apply SI prefixes to physical quantities. As we work with different topics in physics, we'll frequently express quantities with an SI prefix that allows us to avoid using long strings of zeros or even scientific notation. For example, instead of saying that a hydroelectric plant produces 2,500,000 watts of power, we would ordinarily say the power plant produces 2.5 megawatts, where mega means a million or 10 to the sixth. The SI prefix allows us to use small numbers that are convenient for the domain in which we're working. So on the left, we have a fairly comprehensive chart of SI prefixes, and these are all nice, but I want to just highlight the ones that I actually recall using more than once in a physics course. So we've reduced our list a little bit, and we noticed that the prefixes we typically use in a physics course are weighted toward the small side of things, in other words, the negative powers of 10. Let's work a few examples to get how the prefixes work. In the first example, we're told that yellow light has a wavelength of about 5.8 times 10 to the negative 7 meters, so that's scientific notation there. And then we want to express the wavelength in nanometers. If I look at my chart, nano means 10 to the negative 9, and so that's what we try to get out of this scientific notation. The way we're going to get this done is by dividing 10 to the negative 7 by 100. In other words, dividing it by 10 squared subtracts 2 from that exponent and gives us 10 to the negative 9. So we're going to make up for that by multiplying the 5.8 by 100. So we multiply it by 100 and get 580. Again, we divide the power of 10 by 100. And I get 580 times 10 to the negative 9 meters. And the whole point, of course, is then to call 10 to the negative 9 meters a nanometer. And I get 580 nanometers for my answer. So nanometers are the units we'll typically use when we're discussing wavelengths of visible, ultraviolet, and even X-ray light. In the second example, we're told that atmospheric pressure is about 101,300 pascals. And we're asked to express this in kilopascals. When we look at our chart, we see that the prefix kilo means 10 to the third or 1,000. So it's as simple as this. I could say this is 101.3 thousand pascals or 101.3 kilopascals. If you want a little more formal approach to this, I could say what I've done here is divide the original number by 1,000 to get 101.3. And then multiply that result by 1,000 to make up for it. And 1,000 is 10 to the third. And then I would replace 10 to the third pascals with kilopascals. So this is another example of a unit that we're using by convention. This isn't scientific notation, and we aren't using the standard form of the number expressed in pascals. People have just agreed to express things in kilopascals when we're talking about pressures that are near this magnitude. In the final example, we're given that the diameter of a uranium nucleus is about 11.7 femtometers, and the diameter of a nucleus is about as small as we go in introductory physics. And we're asked to express this in scientific notation. So 11.7 femtometers is the same as 11.7 times 10 to the negative 15 meters. And this is not in scientific notation yet because I have a number bigger than 10 in front of the decimal point. So I need to shift the decimal point one position to the left. That's the same as dividing by 10, and I end up with 1.17. And if I just divided by 10, I need to make up for it by multiplying by 10 in the second part of the number. Well, multiplying 10 to the negative 15 times 10 adds 1 to the exponent, and I get 1.17 times 10 to the negative 14 meters. So hopefully I've communicated the point here that if you're doing nuclear physics, for example, you want to work in femtometers because the number 11.7 is a really nice, simple number. And it's because we're using the units that are best adapted to doing nuclear physics. This is preferable to saying 1.17 times 10 to the negative 14th if we could say something as simple as 11.7 femtometers. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.